and the things you've believed here in us. It's an honor to see every person in this place. We are so glad to have you. I want you to tell your neighbor, you are the reason why we are here. Every time when it comes, there's a different feel to it. And to see believers from different places gather together with one thing in mind, it's amazing. It's always an honor. Amen. And one thing that I've purposed in my life is that I'll never forget where I stand in Christ. And no matter what you're going through, no matter what you've been through throughout the year, I can tell you the months that are remaining are enough for you to see tremendous growth.
I will stand and lead.
is to worship in your light. Your spirit is so near to me. Lord, you miss nor how. Just express your laughter, Barbara.
That's why every time before we start a meeting,
my favorite hymn. We're singing, what song was that? My Jesus. You know it? My Savior. Oh, my sing that for God in your seat, in your comfort zone. It doesn't have to be complicated. Chapter 3, verse 13. Afterward, chapter 8, verse 10.
Do we have Esther chapter 3? Now, here's a brief background with the book of Esther. There was a king named Xerxes. Was a king named Xerxes? Or was the land Xerxes? Okay, there was a Xerxes somewhere. Hallelujah. Daniel was excited about that. And the guy had a wife named Vashti, right? And you know, sorry, I've just remembered something. You know, with names in the Bible. There was a time I was with my father in the Lord, and he was praying for a certain woman. And you know, she had not conceived. She had been struggling to conceive for I don't know how many years. And he said, okay, what do you want? And she said, I want twins. He said, okay, have you named them? And she's like, yes, what have you named them? Mose, Ananias, Milan, Sapphira. We all burst out in laughter. Hallelujah. So there was a queen named Vashti. And Vashti was not necessarily the most virtuous woman. Amen. So the king ditched her and decided to host a beauty pageant for a new wife. And Esther seemed to have both the inner and outer beauty. So she qualified and she became the king's new wife. Amen. Now, this other guy named Haman, it's been a while since I read Esther. He did not like the Jews. And so he somehow got the king to write a certain letter. Now notice, what does it say? Esther 3, right? And the letters were sent by the couriers into all the king's provinces to destroy, to kill, and to annihilate all the Jews, both young and old, little children and women in one day. On the 13th day of the 12th month, which is the month of Adar, and to plunder their possessions. Do you see that in that letter there was stealing, there was killing, there was destroying? And have you noticed that when the letter was read, the Jews mourned? Now you see, the book of Esther is not just about makeup and lip gloss. There is so much spiritual depth in the book of Esther. Because when I see that letter, it reminds me of the time when something was written that wasn't in itself evil, but could be taken advantage of by the evil one. Because there was a time when God wrote a letter. They were called the Ten Commandments. And on that day, people died. How many of you remember? People died on the Ten Commandments were read. So meaning, on that day, there was a lot of mourning in the camp of the Jews, which reminds me of the day this letter was written. We're going somewhere. Esther chapter number 8. Now you see, Esther, for a while, she forgot why she was put in her position. And Mordecai rebuked her and said, you know what, if you're not going to help the Jews, go to raise someone else to do it. Whatever position of progress God puts you in, it's not for yourself alone. It's so that you can help others make progress. Amen. Don't forget that. And the funny thing about God is that He can raise someone much better than you. Perhaps even much better looking. Hallelujah. Are you understanding my point? You'll be shocked. God decides you're going to be leading this young new move of God. You decide to sit on your position, you will raise a great servant. Amen. Now that's not my point. Now Esther first went into 3 days fasting, she did not eat. Okay? Now those 3 days were symbolic of the 3 days that Jesus spent. Jesus died, and as we know, it was just like the sign of Jonah, 3 days and three nights. Amen. Are you following? And Esther went into the king's inner chambers and the like, of which only if she had favor with the king was she going to be allowed. That reminds me of someone who, after he rose again, he took the blood to the king. And Esther found favor with the king. Esther found favor with the king. That reminds me of someone who found favor with God. And now you see, when Esther found favor with the king wrote a new letter. Hold on. This was a new letter. Look what it says. And the letter, this is now the new one. Are we Esther 8? Oh, Esther 8, I think it's verse 10. Should be verse 10. Esther 8, verse 10. Look what it says. And he wrote in the name of the king. What does the king say? Ahasuerus sealed it with the king's signet ring and sent letters by couriers on horseback, riding on royal horses and bred from swift steeds. Go on. By these letters, the king permitted the Jews who were in every city to gather together and protect their lives, to destroy, to kill, to annihilate all the forces of any people or province that would assault them, both the little children and women, and to plunder their possessions. Interesting. The first letter brought mourning. The Bible tells us the second letter brought joy. The first letter brought mourning because the Jews were to be killed. The second letter, interesting thing about the second letter is that the second letter did not remove the first letter, but it empowered the Jews. It told them, look, you can protect yourself. Interesting. It reminds me of someone who went before God. And you see, he fulfilled the wrath of God. Okay, that's Jesus. And when he fulfilled the wrath of God, they made a deal. The Bible says Jesus and God had a covenant, according to Hebrews chapter number 8. And the covenant was this. Look, okay, fine. You've done everything you're supposed to do, so listen to me, Jesus. Any person who believes in you, anyone, if they just decide to believe in you, I will never hold their sin against them. And their sins and iniquities I will remember no more. But if you go one or two verses higher, that's Hebrews 8, it tells us that they will not need anyone to teach the other saying, no God. You know what that means? Each and every one of them will have an opportunity to have a relationship with God for themselves. You will not have to gather in a place like this and say, worship! And you know how when people are trying to convince people to worship, they go. Sometimes they will go. Some of your friends are in hospital. Did you watch on news? People are bashed. And then you are here. That's not the right motivation for worship. You do not use other people's unfortunate circumstances to motivate you to worship. But what's going to happen is because this letter will empower them, each and everyone was going to have an opportunity to know God for themselves. And that's what God wants for every person in this place. You see, Jesus is the only mediator. We are here as messengers of reconciliation. We cannot mediate the relationship between you and God. He's the only mediator. And each and every one in this place has an opportunity to know God. Far be it from you that you attend such a meeting and not know God.
Amen.
Now there's something about the book of Esther, chapter 10. Chapter 8, verse 10, sorry. Now, we've understood how the first letter represented the law and the second letter represented the new covenant, right? But there's a topic I want to talk about today that we find from Esther. So for those who only see makeup, they don't deal with you. Now, and he wrote in the name of the king Ahasuerus. So for the letter to be binding, there was a name that was used. sealed it with what? And if you go on, it says, for anything written in the king's name and sealed with the king's ring cannot be reversed. Not even by the king. Ephesians 4:30. I'm sure you know it. What does it say? Okay. What? And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Sealed with the king's signet ring. So the sealing of the king's signet ring in the book of Esther was symbolic of the Holy Spirit. Because now that we are born again, we've been sealed for the day of redemption, as if we've been stamped. You see, when something is being sent by mail, it is stamped with something, and what that which it is stamped with determines where it is going. So Frederick has been stamped with the Holy Spirit. That way, on the day of redemption, they know where I am going. Glory to God. When you are sealed with the Holy Spirit, judgment there ceases to be about where you are going. It becomes about how much I'm getting. Some of you did not get that. It becomes a matter of reward. The Bible says that we are not fearful for the day of judgment. Because if one man died, he already died. Glory to God. My sermon is entitled Holy Ghost Consciousness. I decided to use ghost, not spirit, because it sounds more Pentecostal. Anyways, not that I'm hallelujah. I mean, when you want to say Pentecostal, is a Holy Ghost. Hear me today. Hallelujah. One of these days I'll preach a sermon like that. Holy Ghost consciousness. You can say Holy Ghost, Holy Spirit, same person. I know people have mystified the word ghost, so Holy Spirit consciousness. Glory to God. The Holy Spirit is the most important person on earth right now. Because your salvation, look at that scripture again. It says, do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. What this shows you is that how God looks at you is determined by how you and His Holy Spirit relate. Let me get you thinking. The Bible tells us about a man named Jesus. Okay? An angel appeared to a young lady. She was probably in her teens, as historians believe. And the angel said, look, you're going to be found with a child. And she said, how is this so? Because I do not know a man. And, well, the angel said, the Holy Spirit will overpower you. He will come upon you. As if the Holy Spirit was so powerful that he was able to take the one who in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, bring him into a seed and put him into a teenage woman. And at that point, a teenage woman was carrying God. Interesting. And the Bible says he will be called God's child. Why was he called God's child? Because the one who made Mary pregnant was the Holy Spirit. So in short, for you to be born again, you must be born from the Spirit. That's what John 3 says. It says, that which is born of the flesh is flesh. For you to be born a human being, you are born of a human being. Then it says, that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. So you have to get to know the one who birthed you. You can't know yourself if you do not know the characteristics of the one who birthed you. So, Jesus was recognized as God's child because he was born of the Spirit, literally. Hold on. You go to Matthew 3. When Jesus was being baptized, the Bible says the Spirit of God descended upon him like a dove. And for the first time, we hear God shout from heaven, this is my son. What did he recognize? His Spirit. Interesting. That's why the Bible says, they that are led by the Spirit, these are the sons of God. So, your maturity levels, your Christianity levels are determined by how you are treating the king's signet ring. Interesting. You must understand that the Holy Spirit is very important to God. So important that Jesus I find the way the Father, Son, and Spirit relate interesting. You know why? Because the Spirit doesn't talk about himself, he glorifies the Son. Have you noticed that? And he reveals the Father. And the Son is the way to the Father. And then the Father and the Son love the Holy Spirit so much that they're very defensive over him. Hallelujah. Say, Holy Spirit consciousness. Now, there are three aspects to Holy Ghost consciousness that I want to highlight today. But first, let me say something. Do you know that Jesus called the Holy Spirit his Father? Have you noticed that Jesus said, my Father who is in me, he does the works. That's different from he said, from when he said, my Father which is in heaven. So Jesus recognized the Holy Spirit, is one that birthed him. But I want to say a few things. Now, in the book of Exodus, God told Moses to make the anointing oil. How many of you remember that? God told Moses to make the anointing oil. And you remember there were the four spices and the like. And he had a powerful teaching on that. 2015, somewhere there. Made someone talk. Anyways, God commanded that that oil should never be made again. I'm going somewhere. How many of you remember that? God said, no, I should never make that oil. Do you read the book of Exodus? Okay, do you read the Bible? Okay, let me avoid these areas. So, God commanded that that oil should not be made again. And as time went by, we began to see uses of oil, of which most, a lot of people have concluded that that was anointing oil. But that's not necessarily accurate, because the anointing oil which was made, God commanded that it should not be made again. If you do proper research, you discover usually it was olive oil. Okay? We are going somewhere with this. And as time went by, God symbolically used oil to represent the Holy Spirit. So you notice that David was anointed with oil, and it says the Spirit of God came upon him. So meaning the power was not in the oil, but the oil was a symbolic thing, and because the oil was symbolic of the Holy Spirit recognized it and came upon David, and David would do all sorts of interesting things. The same way, even with Elijah, the power was not in the mantle was symbolic. The same way, even with Samson, you notice that God decided that, okay, what will happen with Samson is this. I've made a covenant. So what will happen is, as long as he has his hair, the Spirit of God will come upon him when he needs the Holy Spirit. So there are all these guys that would have the oils and all those things. And then someone came along, and they called him Jesus. And then he stands and says, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me. Now, questions, anointed him with what? You read Acts 10:38, it says how God anointed Jesus with the Holy Ghost and power. Imagine how much power someone walked in. Others were anointed with oil and the Holy Spirit recognized. He was anointed with the very Holy Spirit. And we are coming to a place. We've got so many people who've exalted substances that they've missed out on the real deal. So many people who've exalted oils and all sorts of substances, towels and papers and all those things, and they've missed out on the very person Jesus wanted to give us. You think Jesus would die so that your life can be dependent on whether a bottle of oil is finished or not? Sorry, I have to say this. Look, I'm not against the symbolic use of oil or any substance. But I've got a problem with what's going on now. People's concept of God is being limited to a portal. The moment that happens, your consciousness it, someone has to talk about it. The moment substances keep being used, it means there's a certain high level of childishness in the body of Christ that needs to be eradicated. Until we come to a place where we can already recognize him. Someone would say, well, but handkerchiefs and aprons were taken from war. Yes, but that wasn't his doctrine. His doctrine was, I long to see you that I may impart you with something. So his doctrine was impartation. I would rather anoint a person than a substance. Because what that person will be able to do with the anointing. If it's substance which doesn't have a brain, they will deal with a demon. How much more a human being who can think? Hallelujah. The biggest thing that has influenced me with regards to where I am today is consciousness of the Holy Spirit. Now let me mention my 3 points. Are you ready for this one? Number one, you must be conscious of the person of the Spirit. Let me explain this. What am I saying? You must be conscious of the person of the Spirit. You must literally have a relationship with the Holy Spirit as a person. You see the person of the Spirit introduced in John chapter 14. When Jesus said, in 15 he said, if you love me, you will be my commandments. In 16 he said, and I will pray in the Father, and he will give you another helper. I've on purpose used the word helper. There are about 7 words you can use here. You can use helper, you can use comforter, you can use intercessor, you can use standby, you can use friend, you can use advocate. And all of them have got a separate meaning. But why have I said helper? Because here is something. A lot of times we've emphasized on the baptism of the Holy Spirit, which deals with power, and that's important. But we must also emphasize on the indwelling of the Spirit, because that deals with fruit. That's what produces holiness. You can never have holiness without the Holy Spirit. You cannot produce fruit without the Holy Spirit. Because Jesus said, once you disconnect from the vine, you can do nothing. The Holy Spirit is a person. Now, why have I used the word helper? Because God knows you need help. Before coming here today, when I put up, first thing I did, I went on my knees, I thanked God for the opportunity to minister to everyone. And I was just checking that God is still here. Of course, I know he never leaves me nor forsakes me. But one thing that has really helped me personally with my Christian life is when I have discovered that I actually need help. The disciples were mentored by Jesus, best Bible school ever. 3 years, got a degree in divinity with Jesus Christ himself. And yet he said, don't do anything until the Holy Spirit comes. Why? Because God knows you need help. So if you are ever in a moment where you are feeling, I don't know, drained, where you are feeling down, maybe you are feeling pain and you feel you can't bear it on your own, maybe the burden of certain things is too strong, that's the time you need the helper. That's not actually the time to run away from help. Because the Bible says he's our ever-present help in times of need. But so many people want to be so cute before God. Like they want to wait until everything is okay so they can go before God. And no. You really get to know God in the tough times. Hallelujah. There are neighbor. You need help. That's why Jesus sent the helper. Stop ignoring the helper. No, that wasn't me. Stop ignoring the helper. That was me. Like, stop ignoring the helper. Hallelujah. Every person needs help. Now, let me tell you what a relationship with the Holy Spirit does. What it really deals with the issue of sin. If you want to stop living in sin, have a relationship with the Holy Spirit. You know what will happen? You'll be too conscious of his presence for you to do certain things. I gave this example last night. Right now, as we're speaking, I want everyone to yawn carelessly. No one has done it. But when you're on your own, in your bed and you wake up, most of you will. But why can't you do it right now? Because you are conscious of the presence of everyone. Now, when you become conscious of the presence of the Holy Spirit, it's difficult for you to do certain things. It's my wife. There was a time where I remember I was driving, and by the way, my first few months of driving, I really needed counseling from the Holy Spirit. That's when I realized that driving in Lusaka, you can develop a temper. I used to wonder when people do it. Before I do it, I call myself, Lord, you're doing it! You win! Can you stay there? And then I remember the man of God. Drive the witness. Like that. You know, one time, I'm entering, no, I'm driving, and some guy just enters the road. British road, and you know, you're driving at a reasonable speed. And I stopped, and he didn't need anything, no apology, he just continued driving. Everything in me just felt like going and overtaking him and stopping the car and just kicking him with me. But here's something, I was driving once and someone made a mistake. This is how I stopped talking that much. Still working in it. And I lowered the window and I was about to say something. And I heard the Holy Spirit say, what would you do if it was your mom who was actually driving that car to make that mistake? I said, I wouldn't shout. I said, why? Because I know when I go home, I'll find her. It's very easy to say certain things to people you want to be. Have you realized that? Now, you see, for me, I wonder how a person, I've seen cases, someone can be preaching like this, but their life is completely something. I wonder, that's some of us, listen, we don't leave the Holy Spirit here. We actually get with him, we go back together. This is not even a church, it's a government. It's a government building. As in, they can have just some crazy function if they want tomorrow. Where do you leave the Holy Spirit? The day he realizes in you, how can you take the Holy Spirit in that car? From today, every 5 minutes, say, Holy Spirit, I know you're here, and with what I am doing, I know you're watching. The problem is people are the world of consciousness of God who's very high in heaven. My prayer when you're born again is in you. I get this example, and it sounds funny, but let me give it. Let's say Zimema, come. You can stand over there. Daddy, you can go. Since you guys are not really doing much. And let's pretend Diana is not there. I've seen this happen a lot. No, for now, just move like this. So let's say Zimema is this chick guy. And he's walking, like this guy walking. Can have a step if you want, like a guy. And then let's say a lady is passing by. Have you noticed a lot of guys who escort with their eyes? Now, hold on. Come back. Let's say, however, that day, Zimema happens to be walking with his mother. Oh. And then, even if he wants to escort his mom. Not just any mother, African mother. If the Holy Spirit has never told you apologize, you need to work on your hearing. Because the Holy Spirit does not tell you things to make your ego big. Yeah. The moment you feel your ego is growing, just go in the presence of God, go calm down. The Holy Spirit is is very good at saying apologize, because he loves you as much as he loves them. And then the thing about the Holy Spirit is this. Like, if you are not happy with someone, that won't affect his relationship with them. The day you realize that, like, God doesn't love you any less because you don't love him. Hallelujah. Everybody say, the person of the Holy Spirit. Then turn to anyone and say, do you know him? So just start doing that. Let me tell you one more reason with the sin issue. I want you to imagine someone you really, really love. And then you were offered, saying, we'll give you $1 million. You like $1 million, right? If you stab them in the hand. And they tell you, don't worry, they won't die. They'll just be injured, but they'll heal eventually. Let me tell you something. What would hurt me more is not the fact that someone is not the pain of being stabbed. What would hurt me more is how can they do this to me when they love me? I don't know if you get my point. So you reach a point where the reason why you don't sin is because you love God. It graduates from being afraid of hell, from being afraid that you'll get angry. You reach a point where you just love him so much that you don't want to hurt him. That's why the Bible says, do not grieve the Holy Spirit. And the message says, do not break his heart. I'm going to say glory.
Glory.
Okay, let's quickly go to the last two. Number two, you must know the Holy Ghost baptism. Okay? There's a person, then the baptism introduces the power. I don't know how to preach without miracles. I've tried. It doesn't work. You know why? Like I've told you, I'm bored with theories. My entire time at university, I was taught theories. I'm still studying now. Most of what I'm taught is theories. I'm bored with that stuff. I need something real. If I'm going to talk about someone supernatural, then we should say supernatural things. Christianity as a theory is boring. That's why when you go to places like Europe and the US and some of those places, you notice in the churches, they're just old people. They're very few young people because they're bored. Because young people want to experience things. I remember the other day when we came to pay for government conference. By the way, thank you to every person who backed us and helps put all this together. We really, really love you. We can't wait for you to do it again. And yeah, the angels must be welcome. Go again. Can I hear it? Go again. Hallelujah. And I remember when we came and they sat me down and they said, wait a moment, how do you manage to gather all those people? I said, ah, we preached the word and demonstrated God's power. But we saw a lot of young people there. Is there like any fancy thing that you do? You know, young people don't like these things. I said, who told you young people don't like this? The Bible says Jesus is the desire of the nations. If you present Jesus as he is, he's attractive to anyone. Somebody say glory.
Glory!
Now there's the baptism of the Spirit, which brings about the aspect of power. Can I say a few things about the baptism of the Spirit? Just one or two thoughts. Everybody say, I'm thinking.
Amen.
Say it one more time.
Amen.
Okay, now look. When Jesus was about to leave, in Acts chapter 1, he told the church, don't stand. Father promised. For John baptized with water, but in a few days he'll be baptized with the Holy Ghost. And then the question then in verse 8 he says, but you shall receive power when the Holy Ghost was come, and you'll be my witnesses. Now, a witness is somebody who gives evidence. The best witnesses are those who can give evidence beyond reasonable doubt. Now, look at it this way. Why is it that the disciples were not allowed to be witnesses until they had the Holy Ghost? Are you ready for this? Say, I'm ready. When these disciples who actually saw Jesus, when they witnesses to his ministry, when they witnesses to his miracles, when they witnesses to his death, those are ran away, but when they witnesses to his death, don't you think they would qualify to be witnesses? I was having a chat with the man of God, but having done this morning. I was studying the book of Matthew. I was studying, usually for me, even if I'm preaching, I still continue with the way I study the Bible because I study for my sake. So I was just studying something completely unrelated to this. And I was reading on the Great Tribulation and everything. Then there's something that Jesus said. He said, this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached to all nations. And I never realized it. Then Dan explained it to me and says, notice, it doesn't say the gospel, it says this gospel. Meaning there's a certain kind of gospel Jesus wants to be preached in all nations. So in short, if the disciples never had the Holy Spirit, they would have preached the wrong gospel. Let me tell you the gospel they would have preached. They would have preached a life history. Jesus does not want to be a eulogy. Jesus wants to be a living being to people. So without the Holy Ghost, all they witnessed was his life up to his death. That, my friends, is called a life history. That's why many churches are dry, because they are preaching a life history when it is funeral. That's a funeral. Life histories are given at funerals. But guess what Jesus wanted? Why did Jesus only choose the Holy Spirit as the perfect witness? Simple. Because only the Holy Spirit was present when Jesus was being resurrected.
Somebody say glory.
Now number three. for the day. The Holy Spirit, you must be conscious of the Holy Spirit as a governor. Jesus said, but when he, the Spirit of truth, has come, that's John 16, I believe, verse 13, he will guide you into all truth. Many people have limited the Holy Spirit to spiritual things. Many people have limited the Holy Spirit to a 5-minute cameo, you know, during a church service where there's always that old lady who doesn't stop praying. Like, that's the only time the Holy Spirit moves. But the Bible tells us that he will guide you into all truth. Many of us have only allowed him to guide us into some truth, but he wants to guide us into all truth. I love listening to sermons. I love submitting to people and learning things. But I can tell you, most of what I've learned has been from the Holy Spirit. Even when people explain to me, the Holy Spirit breaks it down. And you know, when I was studying, they told us you've got no experience. And then I realized that the Holy Spirit has got so much experience. Like, all of existence has been there. And I realized that I can walk in his realms of experience. So now the Holy Spirit as a governor. Listen, when a kingdom would colonize another country, they would send a governor. Why? Because that governor will teach them the ways of that kingdom. That's how come you find in Zambia we are speaking English. We were not necessarily the most fluent English speakers. We're going to Mordatwes and the like. Amen. But right now we're speaking English. How come we feel like this is formal dress code? This was not the way Jesus used to dress, because you think Jesus dressed in a nice white suit with his name on it. That's not how he used to dress. He dressed in a robe. But why do we think this is formal? Because we are colonized by a Celtic kingdom, and they sent the governor to teach us those ways. And the first thing the governor did was change our language. That's why when the Holy Spirit comes, the first thing he does is... irresponsible of us to end this session without this. Usually when we start the conferences, when I start my session, I always start by singing the glory of God. And I say, my life is yours, my hope is in you only. My life you hold, and I say, you changed me from sinner to holy. I know what it's like to be transformed. How many of you know what it's like to be transformed? You know what it's like to one day be this person and the next day be another. And be a wonder to all. And I can tell you, this transformation comes from the Holy Spirit. You cannot experience this without being born again. Being born again is not a punishment, it's something exciting, it's liberating. And I know there are people who've come in this place who are not born again. And as I've been speaking, you've been hearing the Holy Spirit. The Bible tells us that if you hear the Spirit's voice, if you hear His voice, do not resist Him as they did in the days of the rebellion. Hallelujah. We want you to have this beautiful friendship with God that we've come to know. I want every eye closed for a moment. And I want to see the hands of every person who's saying, Fred, I may have been religious all my life, I may have gone to church all my life, but I want back. I want to be transformed. I want to be a new creation today. I want you to lift your hand happily again. I've seen a few hands. Keep lifting. You need the Holy Ghost. Don't clap for now. Keep lifting. Now I want you to stand. I can see some are younger, some are older. Stand, please. Those who want to give their lives to Jesus today, stand. And then come on, stand. I want to hear you.
us remaining. You know, it's very important for you to have a relationship with the Lord Jesus at a time like this. It's very special. It is something that is going to live in your spirit and you will not forget a day like this. And there's something special for everybody that's coming. So we want to give just a few more seconds. It's very important that you come. There's nothing to be ashamed of. It's the best decision you've ever made.
Now those who want to be saved, the first group first. I want us to get on our knees. Alright, I'll get on my knees with you. Let's get on our knees. No, that side not yet. Okay. And I want you to say after me with confidence. Just what? No one else, only them. And I want you to say it as loud as you can. This is the best decision you've ever made. Okay? Now say it with me. Lord Jesus.
Lord Jesus.
I believe.
You are.
The Son of God.
The Son of God.
And today.
I confess you.
As my Lord.
Amen.
Just like that. It's not complicated. It's not complicated. I'm so glad to see a variety of age groups coming to give their lives to the Lord. Okay. Be up on your feet. As we're dealing with them, start getting down the names and everything. We're going to pray for you soon.
Make sure your name is taken before you leave. We would like to contact you and help you. Okay? You talked about being born again, just don't give birth to your baby and leave in the hospital. So we would like to help you, we would like to talk to you, we would like to decide for you. So make sure your contacts are available.
Okay. You can deal with the people who are rededicating their lives.
Hallelujah. How many are excited to come back to the heart of worship? Various reasons that cause people to slack. And I can promise you that people love God. But, and you're coming here already, and some of you are seated. So don't look at them and say, I'm a never saved. But I'm telling you that every time somebody comes back, there is still joy in the heavens, number one. And number two, the Lord is going to fill you afresh. Are we together? The Lord is going to fill you afresh. This is a new day for you. And I'll just like you to also get on your knees. It's a very special day. Praise God. Just close your eyes, don't look at anybody. Say, Lord Jesus, today I'm coming back and I'm starting afresh. I receive your mercy. I receive your grace. I will walk in the Spirit and I will therefore please you. I will therefore please you in the name of the Lord Jesus. Amen.
Amen. And where's Kelly? Kelly, you raise your hand. Okay, Kelly's at the back for them. I received messages from those who wanted one of the final 20 copies of my book, Jesus the Healer. During this 10-minute break, try to get them because you might not find them afterwards. And they're the last 20 we're releasing from the saga. So if you've not gotten a copy of that book, get it. It will help you for your healing. It will help you to pray for others to be healed and it will also help you with your faith. So get that. Amen. So we'll give our offering and then take a 10-minute break. Amen.
I just want to say something about the book. That book, Jesus the Healer, has got information that makes him who he is, especially in the gift of healing. So I encourage you. money, no one can buy with cash. Make sure you reserve yourself for God. Hallelujah.
Okay. We can now give our offering. See you in 10 minutes. The basket is here. For those who've come to the front, if you've written your names now, God bless you. We love you so much. And we'll be in touch, but we'll pray for you in the afternoon. God bless you.
just a question. Okay, it wasn't really a problem. Because there are Galapagos.
Thank you. two. Test one, two. Testing one, two. Testing one, two.
I said this time we're not really getting along.
No, I think for 8 to 4.
For 8 to 4. It depends on the format you are using, but it's about 2 hours.
So you keep on having to
do it. Yeah, you go to the left.
You should get more close-up pictures of the lingers.
Testing one, two. One, two, test. Testing one, two. One, two, test. Testing one, two, one, two, test. Testing one, two, one, two, test.
And then the battery is so dang.
The battery, we are in charge.
We are switching.
Testing one, two. Testing one, two. Testing one, two. Testing one, two, one, two, test. Testing one, two, one, two, test.